Tantor Audio presents 50 People Every Christian Should Know, Learning from Spiritual Giants of the Faith, by Warren W. Wiersbe, narrated by James C. Lewis. Preface. These brief biographies originally appeared as magazine articles, 32 of them in Moody Monthly Magazine, 1971 through 1977. And 16 in The Good News Broadcaster, published by Back to the Bible Broadcast. The Moody Monthly articles were compiled into Walking with the Giants and Listening to the Giants, both published by Baker, and the others into Victorious Christians You Should Know, co-published in 1984 by Back to the Bible and Baker. The biographies from the two Giants books later became Living with the Giants, which was published by Baker in 1993. At the request of the publisher, I wrote the chapters on Clarence Edward McCartney and Alva J. McLean, especially for this volume. It pleases me that there is still an interest in Christian biography. One of the goals in my writing ministry has been to encourage Christians, especially pastors, to dig again the old wells. Refer to Genesis chapter 26, verse 18, and get acquainted with the godly leaders of the past who kept the light shining long before we were ever on the scene. I have heard from people in different parts of the world who've read these studies and been helped by them. Many of my readers have especially appreciated the bibliographical information and have searched for these forgotten books. I hope they found them. Many Christians today are so fascinated with the latest religious fads and celebrities that they forget that all of us are like dwarfs on the shoulders of giants, to quote the French philosopher Bernard of Chartres, D.C., 1130. In his essay, History, Emerson reminds us that there is properly no history, only biography. I rejoice that in recent years, at least in the United States, there have been an increase in published biographies, both popular and academic, and I hope this continues. We must remember the warning issued by George Santayana, those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. The past is not an anchor to drag us back, but a rudder to help guide us into the future. I have been helped greatly in my own life and ministry by reading the hundreds of biographies, autobiographies, and histories that have enabled me to write these chapters, and I trust you will benefit from reading them. When I started the Moody Monthly series, I was pastoring Calvary Baptist Church in Covington, Kentucky, near Cincinnati. Then we moved to Moody Church in Chicago, 1971 through 1978. And then to Back to the Bible Broadcast in Lincoln, Nebraska, 1979 to 1989. The magazines I once wrote for are no longer being published. I'm grateful that these articles can be conserved in this volume, and I trust they will inform and inspire you. Warren W. Wiersbe. 1. Katherine von Bora, 1499 to 1552. November 10, 1983 marked the 500th anniversary of the birth of Martin Luther. We've heard a great deal about this courageous reformer and his ministry, but I want to focus our attention now not on Luther the preacher and leader, but on Luther the husband and father, for I want you to meet Catherine von Bora, the nun who became Martin Luther's devoted wife. He called her Kitty, my rib, and he loved her dearly. Catherine was born January 29, 1499, at Lippendorf, Germany, about 6 miles south of Leipzig. When her mother died 5 years later, her father put Catherine into a boarding school, and then, when she was 9, placed her in the Cistercian convent at Nimschen in Saxony. It was not an easy place for a little girl to grow up, but at least she had protection, food, and friends. On October 8, 1515, she was married to Christ, and officially became a nun. Little did she realize that 2 years later, a daring Wittenberg professor named Martin Luther would nail his 95 theses to the church door and usher in a religious movement that would change her life. As the Reformation doctrine spread across Germany, numbers of monks and nuns became believers and sought to escape from their convents and monasteries. Some of the nuns who sought freedom were severely punished, and some who escaped were brought back into even worse bondage. 12 nuns at the Nemshin convent somehow got word to Luther that they wanted to get out, and he arranged for their escape. On Easter evening, April 5, 1523, a brave merchant and his nephew, Henry and Leonard Coppi, drove a wagon load of barrels into the convent, put each of the 12 nuns into a barrel, and drove away. When a suspicious man asked Coppi what he was carrying in the barrels, he replied, "Herring." 3 of the girls were returned to their homes, but the other 9 were taken to Wittenberg, where husbands would be found for them. 2 years later, all of them had husbands, except Katherine von Bora. Luther did his best to match her with a godly husband, but all his attempts failed. The one man she really fell in love with ran off and married another girl. Luther urged her to marry Pastor Caspar Glatz, but she refused. She was living with some of the leading citizens in Wittenberg and learning how to be a lady and manage a household, so that those 2 years of waiting were not wasted. Finally, she let it be known that if Dr. Luther were to ask her to be his wife, she would not say no. It was not that Luther was against marriage, but he knew that he was a marked man and that, if he married, he would only put his wife and family into great danger. He urged others to marry, if only to spite the devil and his teaching, the policy of Rome concerning married clergy. How could a man who was declared a heretic by the Pope and an outlaw by the Kaiser take a wife and establish a home? But as the months passed, Luther weakened. He wrote to a friend, "If I can swing it, I'll take my Kate to wife ere I die, to spite the devil." Not the least of Luther's concerns were the economic factors involved in marriage. He accepted no payment or royalties for his books. His own income was unsteady and meager, and he was known for his generosity to anybody in need. If he wanted to deprive himself, that was one thing. But did he have the right to force his wife to make such constant sacrifices? On June 13, 1525, Dr. Martin Luther and Catherine von Bora were married in a private ceremony at the Black Cloister, the converted monastery where Luther lived. As per the custom, 2 weeks later, there was a public ceremony at the church. A host of friends attended, and the couple received many choice gifts. Of course, the enemy immediately circulated slanderous stories about the couple, but few people believed them. One man even said that their first child would be the Antichrist. Luther was 42 years old. Catherine was 25. Would the marriage succeed? History records the glorious fact that the marriage not only succeeded, but set a high standard for Christian family life for centuries to come. The church historian Philip Schaff wrote, "The domestic life of Luther has far more than a biographical interest. It is one of the factors of modern civilization. Without Luther's Reformation, clerical celibacy, with all its risks and evil consequences, might still be the universal law in all Western churches. There would be no married clergymen and clerical families in which the duties and virtues of conjugal, parental, and filial relations could be practiced. Viewed simply as a husband-father and as one of the founders of the clerical family, Luther deserves to be esteemed and honored as one of the greatest benefactors of mankind." While we're at it, let's give some bouquets to Catherine, too. It was not easy to convert a run-down cloister into a comfortable home. Nor was it easy to convert a hyperactive professor preacher into a patient husband and father. She always called him Dr. Luther, but Luther had a number of pet names for his Catherine. Kitty My Rib is perhaps the best-known nickname, but he also called her Zellbander, which is German for better half. It was not unusual for him to refer to her as My Lord Kate, or even Dr. Catherine. She was an excellent nurse and dispenser of herbal medicines. When he felt she was giving too many orders, he quietly called her Kette, the German word for chain. "There is a lot to get used to in the first year of marriage," said Luther, "and no husband knew this better than he." Accustomed to planning his own day, Luther had to learn that another mind and heart were now involved in his schedule. "Wives usually know the art to ensnare a man with tears and pleadings," he wrote. "They can turn and twist nicely and give the best words." But he had nothing to fear, for nobody was a better manager of a house or home than Catherine Luther. She transformed the old cloister into a fairly comfortable house, and, like the energetic woman of Proverbs 31, she launched into various enterprises to feed and sustain her household. She kept cows for milk and butter and for making cheese that, said her guests, was better than what they purchased at the market. She started a piggery because her husband liked pork, and this gave Luther a new name for his wife, My Lord Kate, Mistress of the Pigsty. She turned a neglected field into a productive garden and even planted an orchard. What produce she did not use herself, she sold or bartered at the market and used the income to purchase items for the home. She even stocked a pond with fish. "Have I not at home a fair wife?" Luther said proudly. "Or shall I say boss?" It was not long before the black cloister became a crowded and busy place. Catherine had not only her own children to care for, 6 of them, but also, at various times, her own niece and nephew, 11 of Martin's nieces and nephews, various students who boarded with them, and ever-present guests who came to confer with her famous husband. Before the Reformation, 40 monks had lived in the cloister. Now nearly as many joyful Christians lived there, learning to serve one another. Luther wisely permitted his wife to be in charge of the management of the home. To begin with, he was far too busy to worry about such things, and he had to admit she did a far better job than he could. Catherine not only cared for him and the household, but she ministered to the needs of people all over Wittenberg. She listened to their problems, gave them care and medicine in their sicknesses, counseled them in their sorrows, and advised them in their business affairs. The town recognized that the Luther household was an exemplary Christian home, and much of that success was due to Catherine. It was not easy being married to Martin Luther. He would let his food get cold while he debated theology with his guests or answered the questions of students. "Doctor," said Catherine one day as the dinner grew cold, "why don't you stop talking and eat?" Luther knew she was right, but he still snapped back. "I wish that women would repeat the Lord's Prayer before opening their mouths." One day he said, "All my life is patience. I have to have patience with the Pope, the heretics, my family, and Kate." But out of those mealtime conversations came one of Luther's finest books, The Table Talk of Martin Luther. Baker Books has reprinted the edition, edited by Thomas S. Kepler, and I recommend it to you. As you read it, keep in mind that it was Catherine Luther who really made the book possible. It was at her table that these sparkling conversations were recorded, while the food grew cold. Luther called marriage a school for character, and he was right. But he realized that his own life was enriched because of the love of his wife and family. When I was teaching the history of preaching to seminary students, I reviewed Luther's philosophy of ministry and read many of his sermons, and I was impressed with the many allusions and illustrations drawn from the home. I was also impressed with Luther's Christmas sermons, and I wonder if they would have been as effective had he remained an unmarried man. As in every home, there were times of trial and sorrow. The Luthers had 6 children: Hans, born in 1526, Elizabeth, born 1527, died in 1528, Magdalene, born in 1529, died in 1542, Martin, born in 1531, Paul, born in 1533, and Margaret, born in 1534. Luther would arise at 6 each morning and pray with the children, and they would recite the 10 Commandments, the Creed, and the Lord's Prayer, and then sing a psalm. Luther himself was an excellent musician. He would then hurry off to preach or to lecture and would be busy the entire day. But Luther was not a robust man, and he had many ailments that often struck him without warning. On several occasions, Catherine prepared to become a widow, but the Lord graciously healed her husband and restored him to her. In 1540, it was Catherine who was despaired of, her condition considered hopeless. Day and night, her husband was at her side, praying for God's mercy on her and the children, and the Lord graciously answered. 6 years later, it was Martin who was being nursed by Catherine. But his recovery was not to be, and on February 18, 1546, he entered into glory. I'm sure that one of his first acts of worship in heaven was to thank God for Catherine. Let me share two of my favorite stories about Catherine Luther. At family devotions one morning, Luther read Genesis 22 and talked about Abraham's sacrifice of Isaac. "I do not believe it," said Catherine. "God would not have treated his son like that." "But Katie," Luther quietly replied, "he did." During one very difficult period, Luther was carrying many burdens and fighting many battles. Usually jolly and smiling, he was instead depressed and worried. Catherine endured this for days. One day she met him at the door wearing a black mourning dress. "Who died?" the professor asked. "God," said Catherine. "You foolish thing," said Luther. "Why this foolishness?" "It's true," she persisted. "God must have died, or Dr. Luther would not be so sorrowful." Her therapy worked, and Luther snapped out of his depression. It is interesting to read Luther's letters to his wife and note the various ways he addressed her. "To the deeply learned Mrs. Catherine Luther, my gracious housewife in Wittenberg. To my dear housewife, Catherine Luther, doctress, self-martyr at Wittenberg. To the holy, worrisome lady, Catherine Luther, doctor at Wittenberg, my gracious, dear housewife. Housewife, Catherine Luther, doctress, and whatever else she may be." After Luther's death, the situation in Germany became critical and war broke out. Catherine had to flee Wittenberg. And when she returned, she found her house and gardens ruined and all her cattle gone. Then the plague returned, and Catherine and the children again had to flee. During that trip, she was thrown out of a wagon into the icy waters of a ditch, and that was the beginning of the end for her. Her daughter Margaret nursed her mother tenderly, even as her mother had nursed others, but there was no recovery. Catherine died on December 20, 1552, at Torgau, where she is buried at St. Mary's Church. On her monument you will read, "There fell asleep in God here at Torgau the late blessed Dr. Martin Luther's widow, Katherine von Bora." They could have added, "Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all." Proverbs 31, verse 29. I suggest that we make either January 29 or June 13 Pastor's Wives Day, not only in honor of Catherine von Bora, but in honor of all pastors' wives everywhere, that great host of sacrificing women of God who make it possible for their husbands to minister. I salute these women who must often turn houses into homes, who carry the burdens of their people as well as their own, who do without that others may have, who cheerfully bear criticism, and who do it all to the glory of God. By the way, what have you done lately to encourage your pastor's wife? 2. Samuel Rutherford, 1600 to 1661. An English merchant traveling in Scotland in the 17th century made this entry in his journal. "In St. Andrews I heard a tall, stately man preach, and he showed me the majesty of God. I afterwards heard a little fair man preach, and he showed me the loveliness of Christ. I then went to Irvine, where I heard preach a well-favored, proper old man with a long beard, and that man showed me all my heart." The first preacher was Robert Blair, who ministered at St. Andrews in Edinburgh for more than a quarter of a century. The third preacher was the great Covenanter and professor of theology, David Dixon, whose commentary on the Psalms has been reissued by Banner of Truth and is worth owning. The little fair man was Samuel Rutherford, one of the most paradoxical preachers Scotland has ever produced. "For generations, Rutherford has inspired the best preaching in Scotland," wrote Alexander White in 1908. "And yet today this man is almost forgotten. He should be known as the saintly writer of the letters of Samuel Rutherford, but most people associate the name with Mrs. A.R. Cousins' song, The Sands of Time Are Sinking, which was inspired by statements found in his letters. This happened to be D.L. Moody's favorite song. Rutherford was born in the little village of Nisbet in the Shire of Roxborough, about 1600. Apparently, he lived a rather careless life during his youth. I must first tell you that there is not such a glassy, icy, and slippery piece of way betwixt you and heaven as youth, he wrote to his friend, William Gordon. The old ashes of the sins of my youth are new fire of sorrow to me. To another friend he wrote, like a fool as I was, I suffered my sun to be high in the heaven and near afternoon, but ever I took the gate by the end. He entered the university in Edinburgh in 1617, began his theological studies in 1626, and in 1627 was licensed to preach. That same year, he was called to Anwath. His life and ministry there put that little village on the map. 30 years before, the congregation at Anwath had enjoyed the ministry of another man of God, John Welsh, the son-in-law of the famous John Knox. Welsh often left his bed in the middle of the night, wrapped himself in a warm plaid, interceded for the people of his parish. When his wife would beg him to go back to sleep, he would say, I have the souls of 3,000 to answer for, and I know not how it is with many of them. It is interesting that both Welsh and Rutherford were exiled because of their preaching and their opposition to the king's encroachments upon the church. When he was on his deathbed, Welsh received word that the king had lifted the ban. So he arose, went to the church, and preached a sermon. He then returned to his bed and died 2 hours later. I visited Rutherford's church at Anwath and was surprised to find the ruins of a barn-like building, 60 by 20 feet. It could not have seated more than 250 people, and yet Rutherford faithfully ministered there for 9 years. I see exceedingly small fruit of my ministry, he wrote after 2 years at Anwath. I would be glad of one soul to be a crown of joy and rejoicing in the day of Christ. Mrs. A.R. Cousin put it this way in her song, Fair Anwath by the Solway, to me thou still art dear. E'en from the verge of heaven, I drop for thee a tear. Oh, if one soul from Anwath meet me at God's right hand, my heaven will be two heavens in Emmanuel's land. The people of the congregation knew that God had sent them a dedicated pastor. They said to their friends, He is always praying, always preaching, always visiting the sick, always catechizing, always writing and studying. Often he fell asleep at night talking about Christ, and often he spoke of Christ while sleeping. Spurgeon once preached a sermon in his sleep. His wife wrote down the main points and gave the outline to him the next morning, and he went to the tabernacle and preached it. In 1630, Rutherford's wife died. He was also to lose 2 children during his Anwath ministry. But in spite of difficulties and the smallness of the place in which he ministered, Rutherford never sought to put himself into a larger place. His own hand planted me here, he wrote in 1631, and here I will abide till the great master of the vineyard think fit to transplant me. Transplanted he would be, but not in the manner he anticipated. For in 1636, Rutherford published An Apology, Argument, for Divine Grace, a book that assailed the weak theology of the day and aroused the opposition of Archbishop Laud's party. Rutherford was tried in Edinburgh on July 27, 1636, and was banished to Aberdeen and warned never to preach in Scotland again. He remained in Aberdeen from August 20, 1636 to June 1638, where he was known as the Banished Minister. It is important to note that Rutherford was not imprisoned or made to suffer physically. He was exiled from his ministry and made to suffer in an even greater way by being forbidden to preach. But history repeated itself, for out of the exile came one of the most spiritual devotional books ever written. Out of Paul's imprisonment came Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians. Out of Bunyan's imprisonment came Pilgrim's Progress. And from Rutherford's exile in Aberdeen came the Letters of Samuel Rutherford. Of course, Rutherford did not write these letters with any thought of publication. He died on March 29, 1661, and in 1664, an edition of 284 letters was published in Rotterdam, edited by his former student and secretary, Robert McWard. The title of his first edition was Joshua Redivivus, or Mr. Rutherford's Letters. Joshua Resurrected seems at first to be a strange title, but if you think about it and read some of his letters, it begins to make sense. McWard considered Rutherford to be a second Joshua, who spied out the spiritual land of Canaan and came back to share the precious fruits with others. The third edition of the book, issued in 1675, contained 68 additional letters. The 1848 edition added 10 more. By the 1863 edition, there were 365 letters, one for each day of the year. Why would anyone want to preserve and read these letters? After all, they were never written for the public eye. They were intimate letters, written from a pastor's heart, to help people he could no longer minister to publicly. 2/3 of the letters were written during Rutherford's years of exile, while his ministerial burden for his people was especially heavy. But here, I think, is the value of the letters. They are heart to heart, and focus on the specific needs of real people. Rutherford's encouragement and spiritual counsel are just as helpful today as they were 3 centuries ago. Let me confess that there are times when Rutherford's writing is a bit too effeminate for me. I am sure the problem was with me and not with the saintly author. Rutherford, of course, steeped his writing in Scripture, quoting primarily from Isaiah and the Song of Solomon. I started keeping a list of references and allusions while reading the letters, but I finally gave up. There were just too many of them. Rutherford had 3 favorite images of the church in his letters: the bride of Christ, the vineyard of the Lord, and the ship. There were hundreds of references to the bride, and Mrs. Cousin included a few of them in her song. There is no question that Samuel Rutherford had an intimate communion with his Lord and was not afraid to talk about it. The bride eyes not her garment, but her dear bridegroom's face. I will not gaze at glory, but on my King of grace. Not at the crown he giveth, but on his pierced hand. The Lamb is all the glory of Emmanuel's land. The allusions to the vineyard are not surprising, since Anwath was situated in farming country, and the nautical images stems from Anwath's proximity to the Solway on the River Fleet. Have all in readiness against the time that ye must sail through the black and impetuous Jordan, he wrote to John Kennedy in 1632. And Jesus, Jesus, who knoweth both those depths and the rocks and all the coast, be your pilot, he wrote to his close friend, Lady Kenmure. Look for crosses, and while it is fair weather, mend the sails of the ship. Rutherford's letters were not written for speed readers or frantic pastors looking for sermon outlines. These letters must be read slowly, meditatively, prayerfully. This perhaps explains why this priceless collection is almost ignored today. We are too busy and too pragmatic. If a book today can be read quickly and easily without demanding too much thinking, and if it contains 2 or 3 outlines or promotional ideas, then it is well on its way to popularity. However, if a book like The Letters of Samuel Rutherford can only minister to the interior life, make Jesus Christ very wonderful, and create in the reader a deeper love for God and the souls of men, then it may have to fight for survival. Before you dismiss Rutherford as an impractical mystic, let me share with you the other side of his life and ministry, which prompted my earlier reference to him as one of the most paradoxical preachers Scotland ever produced. Rutherford was not only the writer of devotional letters, he was also the author of a number of theological works that placed him among the leading thinkers and apologists of his day. In addition to An Apology for Divine Grace, the book that precipitated Rutherford's exile, he also helped write the famous Westminster Confession of Faith, and tradition states that he wrote the famous Shorter Catechism based on that great confession. The story is worth telling. In March 1638, it was possible for Rutherford to leave Aberdeen and return to Anwath. His last letter from exile is dated June 11, 1638, and his first letter from Anwath is dated August 5, 1638. In November of that year, he was officially vindicated by the assembly, and he settled down to minister again to his beloved flock. But in 1639, he was commissioned to take the chair of divinity at St. Mary's College, Edinburgh, and reluctantly he obeyed. Then in 1643, he was sent to London to represent the Scottish Church at the Westminster Assembly. He took Robert McWard, one of his students, to be his secretary, little knowing that one day McWard would give the world the classic Book of Letters. He remained in London until November 1647, when he returned to Edinburgh to become principal of St. Mary's. However, while at London in 1644, he had published a book that was to take Great Britain by storm, a book that almost led Rutherford to the gallows. It was called Lex Rex, Latin for The Law and the Prince. In that day, anybody who wrote about the monarchy had better be loyal or prepared to make a quick getaway. Rutherford was neither. When he was involved in controversy, his stubbornness and devotion to truth could be as strong as the mysticism of his letters. He was an ardent apologist, and he could wield the sword with deadly blows. No doubt his deep love for Christ and the Church gave him courage and daring in the theological arena. What he wrote in Lex Rex would cause little excitement today because we're accustomed to democracy and civil rights. But in the days of Charles I and Charles II, a call for democracy and constitutional rights was a summons for the hangman. In fact, when Charles II was crowned in Scotland in 1651, Rutherford opposed his policies and, because of his convictions, broke with his two close friends, Blair and Dixon. Rutherford wrote to Lady Kenmure, "The Lord hath removed Scotland's crown, for we owned not his crown." On October 16, 1660, the common hangman burned Lex Rex at the cross of Edinburgh, and on March 28, 1661, the drunken Parliament indicted Rutherford and three other Christian leaders. But by that time, the author of Lex Rex was on his deathbed. His reply to the official summons was, "I behoove to answer my first summons, and ere your day come, I will be where few kings and great folk come." He died on March 29, 1661. His last words were, "Glory, glory, dwelleth in Emmanuel's land." Should you wish to get acquainted with Rutherford, I suggest you begin with the excellent essay by Marcus Lone in his Makers of Religious Freedom in the 17th Century. You might also read the chapter on Alexander Henderson, another man of the covenant. Then secure the edition of Rutherford's letters edited by Andrew Boner, because this is by far the best. It is complete. The biographical and historical notes help the reader identify people, times, and places. The glossary of Scottish terms is invaluable, and the letters are arranged in chronological order. Do not plan to read this book in one sitting. Read a letter or two a day, and let the Spirit of God quietly speak to your heart. Granted, Rutherford is not for everyone, but if he is for you, then enjoy this first meeting as long as you can. Alexander White preached a series of sermons from Rutherford's letters, and they were published under the title Samuel Rutherford and Some of His Correspondence. You should read the first two sermons before you begin the letters themselves. They are an excellent introduction to the book and its author. After reading several of the letters, you can see how White interprets them in his sermons. By the way, White also brought out an edition of the Shorter Catechism in his Handbooks for Bible Classes series. And in the same series is John Macpherson's fine history of the Westminster Confession entitled The Westminster Confession of Faith. One of the best studies of Rutherford's life and character is that by A. Taylor Innes in the Evangelical Succession series. It is called simply Samuel Rutherford, and Alexander White himself called it the finest thing that has ever been written on Rutherford. Alexander Smellie's classic volume, Men of the Covenant, should also be consulted. I look not to win away to my home without wounds and blood, Rutherford wrote in 1630. Shortly before his death, 31 years later, he wrote, For me, I am now near to eternity. Fear not, men, for the Lord is your light and your salvation. It is best that we remember Samuel Rutherford not as the courageous apologist or the dogmatic theologian, but as the man who lived so close to the Savior's heart. His pen was always ready to write of the things touching the King. In this day of headache and haste, perhaps it is good for us to heed his invitation to a closer communion with our Lord. Then we can join the testimony Mrs. Cousin put on his lips. With mercy and with judgment, my web of time he wove, and I, the dews of sorrow, were lustered with his love. I'll bless the hand that guided, I'll bless the heart that planned, when throned where glory dwelleth in Emmanuel's land. 3. Matthew Henry, 1662-1714. Suitable to everybody, instructive to all, is the way Charles Spurgeon described what is probably the best-known commentary on the Bible, written in the English language, Matthew Henry's Commentary. Since it was first published more than 250 years ago, this commentary has appeared in many different editions, including a condensation in one volume. Spurgeon recommended that every minister of the gospel read straight through Matthew Henry's commentary at least once during his lifetime. Perhaps he got this idea from his model, George Whitefield, who carried his set of Matthew Henry on all of his travels and read it daily on his knees. Matthew Henry was born at Broad Oaks, Shropshire, England, on October 18, 1662. His father, Philip Henry, was a nonconformist minister who, along with 2,000 other clergymen, had been ejected from his church by the Act of Uniformity issued that year by Charles II. These courageous men had refused to compromise their convictions and give unfeigned consent and assent to the prayer book. They also refused to submit to episcopal ordination. Philip Henry had married an heiress of a large estate in Broad Oaks named Catherine Matthews. Her father was not in favor of the match and told his daughter, "Nobody knows where he came from." But Catherine wisely replied, "True, but I know where he's going, and I should like to go with him." Matthew was physically weak, but it was not long before his strength of intellect and character made themselves known. At the age of 3, he was reading the Bible. By the time he was 9, he was competent in Latin and Greek. He spent his first 18 years being tutored at home in an atmosphere that was joyfully and lovingly Christian. He loved to hear his father preach. A sermon on Psalm chapter 51, verse 17, first awakened in young Matthew a desire to know the Lord personally. He was only 10 years old at the time, but the impression was lasting. When he was 13, Matthew wrote an amazingly mature analysis of his own spiritual condition, a document that reads like an ordinary paper. Often, after hearing his father preach, Matthew would hurry to his room and pray that God would seal the word and the spiritual impressions made to his heart so that he might not lose them. God answered those youthful prayers. In July 1680, Matthew was sent to London to study with that holy, faithful minister, Thomas Doolittle, who had an academy in his home. Unfortunately, the religious persecutions of the day forced Doolittle to close his academy. Matthew returned to Broad Oaks. In April 1685, he returned to London to study law at Gray's Inn. He was a good student, but he never lost the burning desire to be a minister of the gospel. A year later, he returned to Broad Oaks and began to preach whenever opportunity presented itself. And on May the 9th, 1687, he was ordained. Before his ordination, he put himself through a heart-searching self-examination in which he seriously studied his own Christian experience, motives for ministry, and fitness for service. The paper contains both confession of faith and confession of sin. He concluded he was not entering the ministry as a trade to live by or to make a name for himself. He also concluded I have no design in the least to maintain a party or to keep up with any schismatical faction. Throughout his ministry, Matthew Henry loved and cooperated with all who trusted Christ and wanted to serve him, no matter what their denominational connections. Even the leaders of the Episcopal Church admitted that Matthew Henry was a good and godly man. This document ought to be read by every prospective minister before he comes to ordination, and it would not hurt those of us who are already ordained to review it on occasion. A group of believers in Chester invited Matthew Henry to become their pastor, and on June 2, 1687, he began 25 happy years of ministry among them. Though he was in demand to preach in other churches in the area, he was rarely absent from his own pulpit on the Lord's Day. He was married in August of the same year. On February 14, 1689, his wife died in childbirth, although by the mercy of God their daughter lived. Matthew married again on July the 8th, 1690, and God gave him and his wife 9 children, 8 of them girls, 3 of whom died during the first year. His only son, Philip, was born in May 3, 1700, but he did not follow his father's faith or his grandfather's. His interest lay in this world and not in the world to come. God blessed the ministry in Chester so that a new sanctuary was erected and was dedicated on August the 8th, 1700. The effectiveness of Matthew Henry's pulpit ministry reached even to London, and several churches there tried to secure his service. But he loved his people at Trinity Church in Chester and refused each invitation. Matthew was usually in his study before 5 o'clock each morning, devoting himself to the preparation of his exposition of the Word. He had breakfast with his family and always led them in worship, reading and expounding some passage from the Old Testament. He then returned to his study until afternoon, when he would set out to visit his people. After the evening meal, he would again lead the household in worship, using a New Testament passage for his meditation. He often questioned the children and the servants to make sure they had understood the teaching. Often in the late evening, he would put in a few more hours of study before retiring. "Take heed of growing remiss in your work," he warned fellow pastors. "Take pains while you live. The Scripture still affords new things to those who search them." It was not unusual for him to preach 7 times a week, and yet he was always fresh and practical. "No place is like my own study," he said. "No company like good books, especially the Book of God." We wonder what Matthew Henry would think if those ministers who rush about all week, wasting time and then borrow another man's sermon for the Lord's Day. The key date in Matthew Henry's life is November 12, 1704. On that day, he started writing his famous commentary. On April 17, 1714, he completed his comments on the Book of Acts, but 2 months later, on June 22, he suddenly took ill and died. Matthew Henry was not pastoring in Chester when he was called home. On May the 18th, 1712, he had begun his new ministry in Hackney, London. One of the factors motivating his move was his desire to be closer to his publisher as his commentary was being printed. He had ministered 25 years at Trinity Church, Chester, and only 2 years in London. The funeral service was held on June 25th, and he was buried at Trinity Church. Much of the material in Henry's commentary came from his own expositions of Scripture given at family worship and from the pulpit. There is also a great deal of Philip Henry in these pages, especially the pithy sayings that season the exposition. Matthew's purpose in writing the commentary was practical, not academic. He simply wanted to explain and apply the Word of God in language the common people could understand. Several of his pastor friends gathered up his notes and sermons and completed the commentary from Romans to Revelation. When you read their expositions, you can see how far short they fall of the high standards set by the original author. In true Puritan fashion, Matthew Henry had the ability to get to the heart of a passage, outline the passage clearly, and then apply its truths to daily life. True, there were times when he spiritualized the text and missed the point, but generally speaking, he did his work well. one does not have to agree with all of his interpretations to benefit from his observations. In 1765, John Wesley published an edited version of the commentary, hoping to bring it within the reach of the average Christian reader. He felt the current version was too large and too expensive. But at the same time, Wesley also deleted all that Matthew Henry had to say about election and predestination. He also omitted an abundance of quaint sayings, and thus took the seasoning out of the dinner. In his preface, Wesley remarked that he used to wonder where some preachers, whom I greatly esteem, obtained the pretty turns in preaching that he heard in their sermons. But after reading Matthew Henry, he discovered their source. I have a suspicion that this was a gentle criticism of his estranged friend, George Whitefield, who used to read Matthew Henry before going into the pulpit. You will not find Matthew Henry grappling with big problems as he expounds the word, or always shedding light on difficult passages in the Bible. For this kind of help, you must consult the critical commentaries. He did not know a great deal about customs in the Holy Land, since travel to the East was quite limited in that day. Again, the student will need up-to-date commentaries and Bible dictionaries to help him in that area. However, for a devotional and practical approach to Bible exposition, this commentary leads the way. I must confess that I have not followed Spurgeon's advice to read straight through Matthew Henry's commentary, but I have used it with profit over the years. I think Henry is especially good in Genesis, Psalms, and the four Gospels. I have never consulted his commentary early in my sermon preparation, but rather have left him and McLaren and Spurgeon until after I had done my own digging and meditating. Often, just a sentence from Matthew Henry has opened up a new area of thought for me and helped me feed my people. I was surprised to discover that Matthew Henry is quoted in our two leading books of quotations. Bartlett's Familiar Quotations has 14 Henry quotations, and the Oxford Dictionary of Quotations, 3rd edition, has 6. Apparently, Matthew Henry is the originator of the phrase creature comforts, as well as the popular saying, all this and heaven too. Perhaps some enterprising reader could mine some of Matthew Henry's pithy sayings and put them into a book for us. If you want to get to know this expositor and his father better, secure The Lives of Philip and Matthew Henry, published by Banner of Truth. Matthew Henry wrote the biography of his father, and it is a classic. J.B. Williams wrote the son's life, but it is not as exciting. When he was on his deathbed, Matthew Henry said to a friend, "You have been asked to take notice of the sayings of dying men. This is mine, that a life spent in the service of God and communion with Him is the most pleasant life that anyone can live in this world." 4. Jonathan Edwards, 1703-1758. It is unfortunate that many people imagine Jonathan Edwards as a ranting Puritan preacher, pounding the pulpit and trying to frighten sinners into heaven. Of course, most of these people have probably never read his famous sermon, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, or even examined the life of this godly man. For Jonathan Edwards was a quiet scholar, a loving father, a concerned pastor, a burdened missionary, and a man who loved God and longed more than anything else to glorify Him. Edwards was born into the home of Reverend Timothy Edwards in East Windsor, Connecticut, on October 5, 1703. He was the only son in the family. He had 10 sisters. He came from good Puritan stock, especially on his mother's side of the family. Her father was Reverend Solomon Stoddard, revered pastor of the Congregational Church at Northampton, Massachusetts. Stoddard was the accepted spiritual leader of the churches in the Connecticut Valley. In fact, some people called him Pope Stoddard. He pastored there for 50 years, and under his ministry, at least 5 special spiritual awakenings had been experienced. Jonathan Edwards received his schooling at home. At an early age, he learned Latin, and later he took on Greek and Hebrew. He had 2 passionate interests in those early years, science and religion. He watched spiders and wrote an amazing essay about them. He saw the mind and heart of God in creation. Everything in nature revealed to him something about God. But his interest in spiritual things was remarkable for a boy so young. He prayed 5 times each day. With some of his friends, he built a booth in the swamp where they would gather together to discuss spiritual matters and pray. I must confess that the boys' clubs my friends and I formed in our youthful years centered more around fun and games. In 1716, while he was 13, Edwards entered Yale College, where he invested 4 years in undergraduate study and then 2 more years studying theology. It was while he was at Yale that he had 2 life-changing experiences. The first was his conversion when he was about 17 years old. Since childhood, he had revolted against the doctrine of the sovereignty of God. But as he read the first book of Timothy, chapter 1, verse 17, he had a remarkable experience of the sense of God's greatness and glory, and all his theological objections disappeared. As I read the words, he wrote in his personal account, there came into my soul, and was, as it were, diffused through it, a sense of the glory of the divine being, a new sense quite different from anything I had ever experienced before. From about that time, I began to have a new kind of apprehensions and ideas of Christ, and the works of the redemption, and the glorious way of salvation by Him. Edwards was never content to have only book knowledge of God. He sought to experience God in his own life in a personal way. He was not an ivory tower theologian spinning webs of words. He always centered on the experience of the heart. It was this conviction that brought him many spiritual blessings as well as many spiritual battles. His second crisis experience was more intellectual than spiritual, although Edwards would never divorce the mind and the heart. He read John Locke's Essay Concerning Human Understanding and made an about-face in his approach to the problem of how people think and learn. He came to the conclusion that knowledge was not something divorced from the rest of life, but that a man's senses helped to teach him truth. In other words, sensory experience and thinking must go together. Again, Edwards saw the importance of uniting the mind and the heart. This approach would govern his philosophy of preaching for the rest of his life. He would first aim for the heart and move the affections before trying to instruct the mind. In one of his most important books, A Treatise Concerning Religious Affections, Edwards wrote, "True religion, in the great part, consists of holy affections." However, he opposed emotion for emotion's sake. He carefully explained the difference between shallow emotionalism and true affections that prepare the way for men and women to receive God's truth. On January the 12th, 1723, Jonathan Edwards solemnly dedicated himself to God. Earlier, he had made a list of resolutions that he read once each week and sought to obey daily. From time to time, he added to this list as he saw special needs in his life. He used it not as a law to bind him, but as a compass to guide him and as a mirror to help him examine his progress in his spiritual walk. On February 15th, 1727, Jonathan Edwards was ordained and became assistant to his grandfather, Solomon Stoddard. On July 20th of that same year, he married Sarah Pierpont, an exemplary Christian lady who bore him 11 children. It is worth noting that Jonathan Edwards used to spend at least 1 hour each evening with his children before they went to bed. He often studied 13 hours a day, yet took time for his family. He and his wife were very happy together. Their marriage and their home were a testimony to the goodness and grace of God. In February 1729, Solomon Stoddard died, and Jonathan Edwards became the pastor of his church, perhaps the most important congregation outside Boston. Spiritual life in the American colonies was very low, and there was a desperate need for revival. Preachers were generally well-educated, but they lacked a burden for souls and a power in preaching. Some of them were not even converted themselves. I am greatly persuaded, wrote George Whitefield when he visited New England, that the generality of preachers talk of an unknown, unfelt Christ, and the reason why congregations have been so dead is because dead men preach to them. But the preachers were not the only ones to blame. While the founders of the churches had, for the most part, been converted people who feared God, their children and grandchildren were too often unconverted, but baptized, church members. The churches operated under what was known as the halfway covenant. This permitted people to unite with the church if they had been baptized but had not made a profession of faith in Christ. They were baptized as infants, of course. Their children were then baptized as halfway members, but they were not permitted to share the Lord's Supper or vote in church elections. But Solomon Stoddard had gone even further in opening the doors of the church to unsaved people. He decided that the Lord's Supper was a saving ordinance and that unconverted people should not be barred from the table. The result, of course, was a church composed largely of unconverted people who gave lip service to the doctrine but had never experienced the life of God in their own hearts. Obviously, the new pastor and his flock were on a collision course. Edwards had experienced eternal life in an overwhelmingly personal way. It was his conviction that truth must be experienced in the heart as well as understood in the mind. In his study of the Word, he concluded that church membership and the Lord's Supper were for saved people alone. He realized that many of the children of the covenant in the colonies were living in sin, apart from God, and destined for eternal destruction. In 1734, he preached a series of sermons on justification by faith. The time was ripe, and the Spirit began to move. In the next year, Edwards saw more than 300 people unite with the church. Some notable sinners in the town were converted, and some remarkable events took place. This was one of the early phases of the spiritual movement in America historians call the Great Awakening, which covered a period from about 1725 to 1760. Whenever the Spirit works, the flesh and the devil start to work to counterfeit God's blessing. And it was not long before excesses appeared in the revival movement. George Whitefield had joined the movement in 1740, and in some of his meetings, people fainted, cried out with fear, and even experienced fits of shaking. Whitefield, like Edwards, did not encourage these activities, but had no control over them. Ministers who opposed religious enthusiasm openly criticized Edwards and accused him of leading the people astray. So Edwards wrote and published a book on how to discern a true working of God's Spirit, The Distinguishing Marks of a Work of the Spirit of God. It is still today one of the best studies of religious psychology available. That same year, 1741, Edwards was invited to preach at Enfield, Connecticut, and on July the 8th he preached Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, perhaps the most famous sermon ever preached in America. The text was Deuteronomy, chapter 32, verse 35. Their foot shall slide in due time. There was no question that Edwards had one purpose in mind: to shake the people out of their religious complacency and into the saving arms of the Lord. Edwards was always quiet in his delivery. He read from a manuscript and rarely looked at the people. He did not pound the pulpit or shout. He simply opened up the scriptures and warned lost sinners to flee from the wrath to come. The Spirit of God broke into the meeting, and many people came under conviction. Some cried out in fear. A minister sitting on the platform pulled at the preacher's coattails and said, "Mr. Edwards, Mr. Edwards, is not God also a God of mercy?" Edwards had to stop preaching and wait for the congregation to become quiet. He concluded the sermon, led in prayer, and closed the meeting. Those who remained afterward to talk to the preacher were not necessarily upset or afraid. In fact, people were impressed with the cheerfulness and pleasantness of the expressions on others' faces. Concerned with the salvation of the lost, Jonathan Edwards could not continue to live with the compromising situation he had inherited at Northampton. In 1748, he informed the church that he would not receive as new members persons who had not given evidence of salvation, nor would he permit unconverted people to come to the Lord's table. Even though ministers in that day had far more authority and respect than they do today, this step was daring and was violently opposed by most of the other church leaders. There followed nearly 2 years of debate and discussion, and the result was the dismissal of the pastor. Edwards preached his farewell sermon on July 1, 1750, a pastoral message that showed no animosity or bitterness, although certainly the preacher was a man with a broken heart. His text was the second book of Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 14, and his emphasis was on what would happen when ministers meet their congregation in the future judgment. History has proven that Edwards was right and his congregation wrong. The colonial churches that rejected the working of God and refused to examine people as to their spiritual experience eventually turned from the faith and became liberal. The churches that followed Whitefield and Edwards continued to win the lost, send out missionaries, and train ministers who were true to the faith. An unconverted ministry and an unconverted membership are the devil's chief weapons in opposing the work of God. Jonathan Edwards moved his wife and large family to Stockbridge, Massachusetts, where he ministered as a missionary to the Indians. His income was reduced, of course, and yet God provided all their needs. Freed from pastoral duties and church problems, Edwards now had more time to study and write. During those Stockbridge years, 1751 to 1758, he wrote several of his most important works, some of which were published after his death. In 1757, he was named president of Princeton College, an office that his son-in-law, Aaron Burr, later held. He took office in 1758 when a smallpox epidemic was invading the area. He caught the infection through an inoculation that backfired, and on March 22nd, he died. We have had more than 200 years to evaluate the life and ministry of Jonathan Edwards. He was perhaps the greatest thinker that America has ever produced, and yet he had the heart of a child. He was a great theologian, and yet his books and sermons touch life and reach into the heart. He was a rare blend of biblical scholar and revivalist. He had a longing to see people know God personally, but he refused to accommodate his theology just to get results. He was also a man concerned about missions. Even the Encyclopedia Britannica admits, by his writings and example, he gave impetus to the infant evangelical missionary movement. Edwards was not afraid to give his people solid doctrine. His Resolution 28 reads, "Resolved to study the Scriptures so steadily, constantly, and frequently, that I may find and plainly perceive myself to grow in the knowledge of the same." Some preachers today seem to have time for everything else but Bible study and the preparation of spiritual nourishment for their people. It is easy to borrow a sermon from a book or listen to a recording of another preacher's message. Edwards used imagination in his preaching. Like every good teacher and preacher, he turned the ear into an eye and helped people to see spiritual truth. He knew that the mind is not a debating chamber, it is a picture gallery. He was a courageous man who held to his biblical convictions even though they cost him his church and the loss of many friends. He stood with George Whitefield when many were opposing him. Edwards encouraged spiritual awakening even though he knew there would be excesses and abuses. He would have enjoyed Billy Sunday's reply to the critic who said that revivals do not last. "Neither does a bath," said Sunday, "but it's good to have one once in a while." Edwards preached for decisions in an era when ministers were not supposed to disturb the congregation. The works of President Edwards, a single volume, may be available in your local library. Ola Elizabeth Winslow has written one of the best biographies, Jonathan Edwards, published by Macmillan in 1940. She also edited a helpful anthology of his most important sermons and writings, Jonathan Edwards' Basic Writings, New American Library. Jonathan Edwards' On Heaven and Hell by Dr. John Gerstner, Baker Books, is a fascinating and very readable study of this important subject. Dr. Gerstner is perhaps our leading evangelical scholar when it comes to the life and theology of Jonathan Edwards. For a satisfying but readable study of Edwards' theology, read Jonathan Edwards, Theologian of the Heart by Harold Simonson, Eerdmans. Our nation is desperately in need of spiritual awakening, but our emphasis on evangelism apart from doctrine will certainly not do it. The Great Awakening was the result of solid doctrinal preaching that addressed itself to both the heart and the mind. It was preaching that dared to expose sin in the church, and God used it to sweep thousands into His family. Perhaps it is time that we dug again those old wells and learned why their waters flowed with life so fruitfully and so bountifully. 5. George Whitefield, 1714-1770. O Heavenly Father, prayed a 22-year-old preacher in London, for thy dear son's sake, keep me from climbing. That young preacher was George Whitefield, and he had every reason to fear popularity and promotion. Great crowds were coming to hear him preach the gospel, and hundreds were being converted to faith in Christ. He was the boy wonder of London. His preaching shook both Great Britain and the United States, and the results are still with us. Historians tell us that Whitefield preached from 40 to 60 hours a week, a total of more than 18,000 sermons during 34 years of public ministry. He crossed the Atlantic 13 times and ministered extensively in the American colonies. He preached to thousands throughout Great Britain, and this included 3 trips to Ireland and 14 visits to Scotland. I had rather wear out than rust out, he told a friend who protested that he preached too often. He often quoted the adage, "We are immortal until our work is done." When it is learned that Whitefield was not a healthy man, that he often had severe spells of vomiting, and that he arose each morning at 4 o'clock, this record of ministry becomes even more amazing. We need to meet this boy preacher whom Dr. D. Martin Lloyd-Jones called the greatest preacher that England has ever produced. George Whitefield was born in Gloucester on December 16, 1714, into a respectable family that owned and managed the Bell Inn. Whitefield was but 2 years old when his father died, and when his mother remarried 8 years later, the match was an unhappy one. Young George had a good memory and a glib tongue, so he excelled in making speeches in school and acting in plays. Little did he realize that his youthful public appearances would help him prepare for his pulpit ministry. Of course, as a youngster, he got involved in the usual sins of youth, even to the point of stealing money from his mother. But even in the midst of his childhood corruption, as he termed it, he had the conviction that he would one day be a clergyman. I was always fond of being a clergyman, he wrote in his journals, and used frequently to imitate the ministers reading prayers, etc. When he was about 15, he left school to assist his mother in the work of the inn. He continued to read the Bible, even though he was not a professed Christian, and during a visit with his brother in Bristol, he found great delight in attending church. He made vows and apparently had some adolescent emotional religious experiences. But no sooner had he returned to Gloucester than the old life overtook him again. By the providence of God, Whitefield did return to school and then entered Oxford, where he met John and Charles Wesley and became a part of their Holy Club. While the Wesley brothers and their friends were moral and religious people, they did not as yet know much about the new birth. Their Christianity consisted mainly of religious exercises, mutual exhortation, and ministry to the poor and needy. John Wesley gave Whitefield a copy of Henry Scrugel's spiritual classic, The Life of God in the Soul of Man, and the reading of that book opened Whitefield's eyes to the miracle of the new birth. At that time, Wesley himself knew nothing of a regeneration experience. Whitefield did not enter into true life and liberty immediately, but at least he was moving in the right direction. Finally, in the spring of 1735, he cast himself on God's mercy and experienced new life in Christ. He then returned to Gloucester, where he lived with friends for several months. He began his lifelong practice of reading the Bible on his knees and studying his Greek New Testament. Whitefield was a competent Greek and Latin student. He also purchased the famous Matthew Henry Commentary and read it carefully. In fact, the set became his constant companion in all his travels. He gathered around him a small group of new believers, many of them his old partners in crime, as they met weekly for Bible study, prayer, and mutual edification. This was the first Methodist society ever to be organized. It comes as a surprise to many people to learn that it was George Whitefield, not John and Charles Wesley, who founded the Methodist Church. The Wesleys entered into Whitefield's labors and eventually were given the leadership of the movement by Whitefield. Whitefield returned to Oxford in March 1736. The Wesleys had already sailed to Georgia to work with General Oglethorpe in the new colony. On June 10, 1736, George Whitefield was ordained as a deacon by Bishop Martin Benson in Gloucester, and on June 26, he preached his first sermon. The curious congregation, many of them relatives and friends, were amazed at the power and spiritual wisdom of the young preacher. In fact, someone reported to the bishop that Whitefield's sermon drove 15 people mad. The bishop said he hoped the madness would not be forgotten by the next Sunday. That was the beginning of a miracle ministry. In July, Whitefield graduated from Oxford. For the next 2 months, he ministered in London as a supply preacher for a friend. He then preached for 4 months in Oxford, followed by a marvelous ministry in Gloucester, Bristol, and London. Thousands came to listen, and hundreds were brought to the Savior. He personally counseled with hundreds of seeking souls. Wherever he preached, the crowds were great and the benefits were lasting. On February 1, 1738, John Wesley returned from Georgia, a weary and defeated man. His ministry in the colony had been a failure, and, unfortunately, he had left behind a bad name and a number of determined enemies. Whitefield had felt a call to serve in Georgia, and he was ready to sail when Wesley's ship arrived in England. For some reason, Wesley did not try to see Whitefield personally, but he did try to persuade him not to go to Georgia. In his earlier years, John Wesley believed in casting lots to determine God's will for himself and for his friends. Had Whitefield listened to Wesley at that time, what a loss it would have been to the people of the United States. On February 2, 1738, Whitefield set off on the first of 7 visits to the colonies, visits that were greatly blessed by God and helped to spearhead the Great Awakening. Whitefield arrived in Savannah, Georgia on May the 7th. The very next day, in London, John Wesley, very unwillingly, attended that meeting on Aldersgate Street, where his heart was strangely warmed, and he found the assurance of personal salvation through faith in Christ. He then had to preach the word and gradually entered into the ministries that Whitefield had left behind. Whitefield returned to London in December and found himself excluded from all but 4 London churches. He preached again to thousands and experienced a mighty working of the Spirit. He and the Wesleys joined forces in the sharing of the gospel. On January 14, 1739, Whitefield was ordained as a priest of the Church of England. Throughout his ministry, he remained true to those ordination vows. Though his ministry was interdenominational, he was always a faithful son of the Church of England. Finding that he was excluded from the established churches, Whitefield decided to take to the open air. On February 17, he began his outdoor preaching at Kingswood near Bristol. It was a brave day for England when Whitefield began field preaching, Charles Spurgeon told his students. Whitefield collected the miners and their families, about 200 people, and preached the gospel to them. "Blessed be God," said the evangelist, "I have now broken the ice." From that day on, huge crowds gathered wherever Whitefield set up his portable pulpit. from among both the poor and the upper strata of English society. Even the little children crowded close to the preacher to hear him. Whitefield followed this practice both in Britain and in America. Benjamin Franklin calculated that Whitefield's message could be heard clearly by 30,000 people at one time. Whitefield began to organize societies and place mature believers over them to supervise the growth of the converts. By this time, John Wesley was also preaching in the open air, following Whitefield's example. The movement took on the name Methodist from the Holy Club that had been founded at Oxford. Both the preachers and the converts were persecuted by unbelieving rabble, sometimes with the approval of the resident clergy. It was not unusual for Wesley and Whitefield to be pelted with stones and dirt, or worse, or have a dead cat hurled at their heads. But, like the apostles of old, none of these things moved them, and they continued to preach the word and organize societies. Whitefield had two reasons to be interested in America. One was the preaching of the word, and the other was the founding and managing of an orphan's home in Georgia. While preaching in Britain, he often took an offering for the home, and he also encouraged his many American friends to support it. For a long time, the home was a heavy burden on the evangelist, and it probably cost him more in health, time, and energy than it was worth. At one point, he was afraid of being arrested for the debts incurred by the home. Whenever he visited the colonies, he always made his way to Georgia to check on the work, supervise construction, and encourage the workers. The spiritual influence of George Whitefield on colonial America can never be fully estimated. It is no secret that John and Charles Wesley were Arminian in doctrine, while Whitefield was more Calvinistic. The Wesleys opposed the doctrines of election, predestination, and the security of the believer. One day, Charles Wesley even called John Calvin the firstborn son of the devil. Whitefield begged the Wesleys not to bring their doctrinal differences into the pulpit, but the men refused to listen. While Whitefield was ministering in America, John Wesley published his sermon on free grace, in which he openly attacked Whitefield's theology. This painful conflict ultimately divided the Methodists and led to the founding of a Calvinistic Methodist branch, which was particularly strong in Wales. Like most disputes, there were faults and mistakes on both sides, because even the most saintly men are made of clay. Wesley's emphasis on Christian perfection irritated Whitefield, and Whitefield's proclamation of the doctrines of grace upset Wesley. However, it is to Whitefield's credit that he strenuously sought reconciliation and fellowship with the Wesleys. He did his utmost to keep the controversy private. Finally, Whitefield did the one thing his friends had hoped he would not do. He turned the entire ministry over to Wesley and stepped aside as leader. "I have no party to be at the head of," he wrote, "and through God's grace I will have none. But as much as in me lies, I will strengthen the hands of all of every denomination that preach Jesus Christ in sincerity." When his followers protested his decision, he said, "Let my name be forgotten. Let me be trodden under the feet of all men, if Jesus may thereby be glorified. Let us look above names and parties. Let Jesus be our all in all. I care not who is uppermost. I know my place, even to be the servant of all." He sent a letter to the godly Lady Huntington in which he said, "Oh, that I may learn from all I see to desire to be nothing, and to think it my highest privilege to be an assistant to all, but the head of none." Whitefield spent the rest of his days as an assistant to all. The more popular he became, the more the opposition grew and the slander increased. He was even mimicked on the London stage, and obscene songs were written about him. He ignored them all and continued to magnify Jesus Christ. The opposition of the unbelievers did not pain him as much as the division of the believers. "But oh, that division," he wrote, "what slaughter it has made." Early in his Christian life and ministry, Whitefield developed a love for all God's people who held to the fundamental doctrines of the faith. When he was only 20, he wrote in his journals, "I bless God the partition wall of bigotry and sect religion was soon broken down in my heart. For as soon as the love of God was shed abroad in my soul, I loved all of whatsoever denomination who loved the Lord Jesus in sincerity of heart. It was during his seventh visit to America on September 30, 1770, that George Whitefield died in the Presbyterian parsonage at Newburyport, Massachusetts. He is buried there at the church. The fact that Whitefield preached in the open air to crowds of 30,000 and even 40,000 people is of itself astonishing. He was the true founder of the Methodist Church, and yet he handed his leadership to another in order to preserve the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. He raised great amounts of money for the care of orphans and the poor, and he helped to establish several educational institutions. But perhaps greater than all these accomplishments is the life of the man himself. Spurgeon commented, "Often as I have read his life, I am conscious of distinct quickening whenever I turn to it. He lived. Other men seemed to be only half alive, but Whitefield was all life, fire, wing, force. My own model, if I may have such a thing and due subordination to my Lord, is George Whitefield. But with unequal footsteps must I follow in his glorious track." I suggest that you secure the recent 2-volume biography of George Whitefield, written by Arnold A. Dallimore. Do not permit the size of the books to frighten you. These volumes read like an exciting tale of adventure. They are not in the least dull and academic. This is probably the most scholarly and yet the most readable biography of an evangelical preacher to appear in many years. You will learn a great deal of church history and have a better grasp of the situation today after reading these volumes. Then secure Whitefield's journals, published by Banner of Truth Trust. You may even want to read the journals as you read the biography. Its pages are filled with spiritual nuggets that cannot help but enrich your own spiritual life. 6. Charles Simeon, 1759 to 1836. The year 1759 was a good one for producing leadership in Great Britain. William Pitt the Younger was born in that year and became the great political leader during the Napoleonic Wars. That same year also gave Britain William Wilberforce, the Christian statesman who led the fight against slavery. But the man of that year who fascinates me the most is Charles Simeon, a neglected...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.